We are making plant-based lifestyle medicine available to everyone who desires it. With telemedicine, we are removing barriers that prevent many people from accessing this type of care. Lifestyle medicine promotes healthy behaviors, and when adopted, individuals can expect improvement and, in many cases, reversal of chronic disease.
Here we go. Oh, wow. We got a great turnout today. This is super exciting. So guys, tell us where you're from in the chat box. Claire says, nice to see you again.
Hi, Clara. Nice to see you too.
We're just going to log on here and then we'll be ready to hit the roll.
Yeah. And you guys, please share your own stories of food addictions or questions that you have, because this is a powerful topic and I would love to have a robust discussion with everyone about it.
Yeah, I think
Indiana.
I agree. I think, Chris, you're exactly right. These are, this is a very important topic. It's not really recognized as a true addiction, but it's really there because these are foods that are literally manufactured to make us crave them. And so then we feel powerless when we break down and we can't get away from it. So it's so very important that we understand there are some very amazing tools available to you to help you. But also just the eating the right diet will also help help overcome these addictions, because the cravings will go away when you start feeding your body the right foods. So if you are on Facebook, so please feel free to share. And then also please write your comments in the questions. If you're on the plant-based health, I can see those questions. I can't see them other places, but Anthony's going to help us look for things. But please, guys, we're super excited. And okay, do you guys have any specific questions? Oh, we got people from Illinois, yeah. Arizona.
Philadelphia, Zionsville, Indiana. I have a good friend out there. Tucson,
Maryland. Tina, you could stay here. She's just asked if she'd be on Facebook, but no.
North Creek, Utah. Awesome. Gurnee. Yes, Sue, you're from Gurnee. We talked about that. Great America. It's an awesome town.
Absolutely.
Welcome, you guys. It's so good to have you all here.
Okay, so... And then So Chris, you want to start maybe with a little bit of you said you had some things that you'd like to share with your own journey. Mm-hmm. And I could talk about Thin Mint, cookies from Girl Scouts later.
We all have a Thin Mint cookie Girl Scout story, I feel like. So my story, how I want to start this off is before I went plant-based, I was getting ready to fly to a weekend in New Jersey to work with Dr. Furman and to even learn this. I hadn't read a single plant-based book. I was eating standard American diet. I actually hid food throughout my house, like in the cabinets and a few places. Not a lot, but a few things that I thought I would need, because I had heard that I was going to be going vegan. And I was so afraid that I wouldn't be able to do it that I hid food, because I didn't want my husband to know that I wasn't strong enough to do it. And so I did that. And that just shows me, I mean, that's clearly not normal, right? I mean, that's so weird when I think about it now, but it is what I did. And so after the weekend, after 3 days immersed in plant-based food, I was able to come home and throw everything out and never needed it, never went back. But it's just a sign of how weak I am or how weak I thought I was. Because what we know about food addictions now is that it's more than just willpower. It's more than just weakness. It's actually brain chemicals. It happens for real reasons. And while it may not be fully recognized as a full addiction, it has been recognized as being extremely powerful and lighting up similar areas of our brains, and something that we can't necessarily control. So it's not like it is just willpower. It's far way beyond just willpower and just being a weak person. So, that kind of opens up the topic. Lori, I don't know if you want to share your story now, or if you want to jump into this.
Yeah, because I think, a lot of times people don't realize what we mean by food addiction in the sense like, so remember addiction, the actual definition of addiction is continue to do something even though there's going to be adverse or negative effects to your health, to your well-being, to your mental states, whatever. For example, an alcoholic, you can determine if someone has an alcoholic problem, they continue to drink, and they're driving while under the influence, their relationships are breaking down, they're not attending work. So these are more obvious solutions, but let's think about food, right? So food, when we consume these highly processed, highly palatable foods, we're getting diabetes, heart disease, high blood pressure, obesity, all of these things that come along with an unhealthy diet. So My own personal walk with food addictions is, it's not like I have a massive food addiction and I had health problems for it, but it does speak to, you know, when you associate feelings or emotions to a food, you know, that's why people get really, some people are very, very offended when you talk to them about giving up maybe meat and dairy because, you know, it's a part of my culture, and they're not saying there's nothing wrong with that, but, you know, we have to think long-term about our long-term health, and you can make healthier versions of culturally relevant foods. But when, you know, a funny story is, you know, those little Girl Scouts, they come out, what is it, in their springtime or something, and they're sitting out there in their cute little skirts and their moms, and they're raising money. And, you know, I'm a mom of three kids. I'm always a big fan of, you know, helping out. Well, then they had those Thin Mint cookies. And for the life of me, I can't just eat one. I have to eat like the entire sleeve. There's two sleeves if you guys haven't delved into one. And then the next sleeve. And it got so bad that my kids were like, Mom, we can't let you buy these cookies. You'll eat them all in one sitting. And it was just a funny thing because there's something about chocolate and that crunch. And they, if that's a perfect example, is they really created just the right crunch, the dissolving little bit of it, the flavors. And then it goes away quickly before you realize that you feel satiated. So these are the things, but I'd actually have people buy me stuff and stick them on my desk just because I thought it was funny because, you know, the healthy doctor and you can't stop yourself. And so what ends up happening is I either, you know, throw them away or give them away or something. But yeah, so that's just, you know, I always make fun of myself in the sense that it's those darn Thin Mint cookies. But that, you know, obviously that's just a funny story, but they have some serious consequences otherwise. But
Do you and have you brought up a good point, Lori, because and that's why I think it is a real addiction, because exactly what you said, that it's something that you can't stop even if it's harmful for you and you know it to be harmful. So we now have data. We know that certain foods are causing diseases. A doctor may have recommended that you stop dairy or you stop sugar, but you're still eating it. Why? Why would you do this? You're self-harming and you already know differently. The other part of the addiction definition is that you have withdrawal from it. You experience an actual physical or mental withdrawal, and we definitely have withdrawal. We know from sugar, for example, that people get really cranky, irritable, headachy. So we definitely even withdraw. And we know now from studies that when they did functional MRIs of people that were drinking sugar solution and people that use cocaine, it lit up the same part, the nucleus accumbens, the same part of the brain where they have a high number of dopamine, the pleasure neurotransmitter in our brain. Same exact thing, sugar and dopamine. So it's causing a similar type of addiction. And in rats, when given the choice of cocaine or sugar water, they chose the sugar water, actually. So
and it was like over 95%, if I recall. It was high 90s.
Yeah. So that these are just all examples of how addictive food is. But because we have to eat and it's socially acceptable, we struggle with it. And there are people who have struggled with cocaine addiction and food addiction, and they'll say the food addiction was harder for them to overcome. And so it's a powerful, and it has many of us in its throes without realizing. And what we'll notice as physicians is if a patient is very resistant to give something up, then that's a food addiction. And I often say to my patients, well, you would give up carrots for a month. If I said carrots are hurting your health and causing your high blood pressure and your heart disease, I want you to go a month without carrots. You'd be like, fine, great, done, easy peasy. You're not addicted to carrots. But if I say, I want you to give up that cheese for a month, it's hurting your health, it's causing these problems. Oh my God, I can't give up cheese. No way, this plan isn't for me. That's not your rational brain thinking, that's your food addiction. And so it's something that we have to delve into, because it's a bigger thing than just mind over matter at this point. Some people can be like, oh yeah, I'll go for it. Other people, it's a little trickier, right? I mean, this is what we're talking about with some of our patients.
Yes.
Chris,
you're exactly right. So you're talking about, again, we're not making rational decisions based on rational thought of outcomes, right? So I wish we were, could be more, you know, that's what makes us human, are these emotional components. But, you know, someone asked, are there degrees of food addiction or is it all or nothing? And I would say certainly there are certain degrees, right? So, because I know that when I went on a whole food plant-based diet, the hardest thing for me to give up was cheese. I still did it, but it was like I had thoughts and missing it. And so there was certainly, but it wasn't to the degree that it was harmful to my health at that point. But it doesn't mean that it wouldn't have led to issues. And I'm sure when I was a child, you know, all the constipation that I had and all the things, it was probably related to the dairy that my, you know, parents can, you know, force upon us. But, you know, there are a lot of strategies that you can use to overcome food addictions. But the first thing is you've got to understand you have an issue and that you're not powerless. So that's the key. And not, you know, this is a journey. There's not like, oh, and now I know I'm just turning off that craving switch. No, it doesn't work like that. There's back and forth and successes and failures, and eventually get more successes and less failures, and it becomes easier. You know, of course, I'm a huge fan of Dr. Judd Brewer. And if you guys check out his website, it's called drjudd.com. These are some tremendous resources. One in particular regarding food addiction is called Eat Right Now. It's an app you can download on your phone. And I've been studying this mindfulness stuff that he teaches, and it's phenomenal. And I've interviewed him several times, but we can go into the habit loop and stuff. But Chris, do you have any, you know, potential things that you like to share with your patients before I go into what I do with mine?
Yeah, I do a different approach actually. So I don't know if you want to, I can do my approach now. So I am not one who really responds well to mindful eating. So, and I know some people do have great results with it. And I took a quiz, you guys, that I will share right now. And it's through Susan Pierce Thompson, who's a PhD who suffered from major food addictions till she learned how to overcome them. And she has a quiz. You can find it if you Google her name or Brightline Eating Food Addiction Quiz. You can pull it up. And it's about 10 questions. It's not horribly long. But it'll ask you questions like, have you ever eaten when you knew it was bad for you? Have you ever driven like late at night to get food? Have you hid food? Have you eaten when you're already full to the point of being sick? And I answered basically yes to all of those. I was a 10 out of 10 on her scale. And so what she has, and she's a PhD, big time researcher. And she has found that about 20% of people score low, like 1 to 4 or 1 to 3, something like that, score low, low food addiction. So they can eat a Girl Scout cookie and be fine. And they put it down. So for those people, that 20%, one Girl Scout cookie is totally fine. They can eat that bite and get on through life. Then she found about 60% of people are in the middle between 3 and 7. And those people, 4, 5, 6, something like that. Those people can, some of them, the low, especially the lower end, can get away with a little bit of something. They can have a few bites. They can do a little moderation and get away with it. They can maybe do a cheat day here and there, a cheat meal here and there, and be fine with it. And what she found, which I thought was hilarious, is that most dietitians fall in this middle range. So a dietitian, when they tell you, oh, eat moderation, that's because that's what they experience. They experience that they can eat moderation and they get away with it. And then about 20% of people are in the high range, the 8, 9s, and 10s, right? Of which I was 10 out of 10 on her scale. And those people, we can't do moderation. It will not work, and it never works for me. And so, and I know this over and over again, if I even have, this is so unfortunate, but I'm just going to reveal it. If I even have a plant-based dessert, it lights up my brain, my dopamine receptors. I now crave more desserts. I crave more overeating. I crave more snacking. I just crave food, and I want more sweets. Even a perfectly designed plant-based dessert, unless it's not very sweet, if I make it not very sweet, then I can get away with a bite or two. But for the most part, even that one bite, and what it does is it sabotages my plan to eat high raw, to eat mostly vegetables, to be on these healing plans and feeling great until I had that, even that one thing. And I learned on my own, even before I did that quiz, that I'm an all or nothing. When I have none, I feel fine. I don't think about it. I don't crave it. It's out of sight, out of mind. I wouldn't even want a plant-based dessert. I wouldn't want real chocolate. I wouldn't want a Thin Mint Girl Scout cookie the way I used to, because I haven't eaten it so long. It's easy. I'm not willpowering it. I'm not mind over matter, nothing. Easy peasy right now because I feel good. I eat a good nourishing diet, which we'll talk about the importance of a good diet also. But if I have even one, even a little bit of dried fruit sometimes can do this to me because I know myself. And so in working with patients, and the answer to your question when Tina was asking, is there difference? There's totally differences. And people who are on the high scale, and you don't even need to take the test. I think most of us know, I already knew I was like this. It's not like that test told me anything. It just was kind of interesting that, oh, look, But you know yourself. You know that if this is going to happen. And for those of us, it's not moderation. It's not cheat days. And yes, we have to really go for it and take it 100% out of our lives. And we'll be okay. We will be okay with this. For other people, if they're low on that scale, they can have a little bit and do okay. They can maybe do some mindfulness and do all these great tricks will be very effective for them. And those people are going to have amazing success and do just fine. And of course, we're all different. So I do all of these tricks. I do mindfulness. I do my none, don't let myself have any. And I feel good and it's part of my life now. So when in so your guys' answer is that know yourself, know what works for you. And we're going to have to, you have to build different plans to help you reach your goal with these food addictions.
Yeah, absolutely. So I would agree. I tend to have people be all or nothing because I think it's just like, you wouldn't tell an alcoholic, oh, you can have a little sip of something on the weekends. Cause I think you're just triggering those old, you know, parts of the brain that's like, oh, I remember that. And that was really good. Let's have some more. So Definitely. So the mindfulness is what I'm describing is not in the sense of I'm being mindful to be in moderation. I'm not, trust me, I've told people multiple times, moderation kills. So what I, especially when it comes to like a whole food, you know, plant-based diet and people like, oh, well, occasionally I can have this. I'm like, I tend to lean in this direction because I know human tendencies. So the key here is not only with mindfulness is understanding that you're actually not a victim to the physical sensations or the thoughts of a craving. And that's where Dr. Jeb Brewer's work comes in. So basically, just to make it a very brief explanation, I go into detail about a habit loop. And so when I try to explain what a craving is, so remember, you know, you have a cue, a trigger. So let's say someone who's smoking, it's a little bit easier. Or even eating, I guess, if someone's stressed and they're used to smoking because they feel better after they do the habit of smoking, right? So their cue is their boss sent them an email that was stressful. They had an argument with their spouse, or maybe they're bored, or maybe they're tired, or maybe they're whatever. That usually is a discomfort. So they're like, I need something to feel better. The brain's like, I need to feel better. So you do this habit, smoking, eating, whatever it is. And then we can go into how those habits are laid down, but this, we're just going to talk about the habit loop right now. But that leads to the reward. And the reward is I feel calmer when I smoke nicotine and I feel better with this habit. I'm socializing with people when I'm smoking, or I feel better because I get a dopamine rush when I'm eating this high sugary, high fat food. And then it builds into this craving because every time we do that activity, you're getting one more railroad track of that neural activity. The body's like, or the mind's like, you know, every single time I get stressed, I need you to do this because I feel better. And you get that craving, it's that sensation. So all the mindfulness does is bring you out of just the automaticity of a habit of just doing it mindlessly, would be an example, versus being aware of the actual situation. So I interviewed Dotsy Bosch, who's the Olympic, she was the track bike rider who won silver, great story. She talks about using... She didn't label it mindfulness, but it's exactly what it was. In our interview, she talks about how she had these horrible, she is anorexic, she had bulimia, she had a cocaine addiction, but she was seeing a therapist who said, you know, before you do this, I'm not going to tell you to try and will your way through this and stop it, but I want you to put a sticker on whatever triggers you, the trigger, the cue, the toilet, the refrigerator. And before you do that, I need you to stop and sit for a minute to 2 minutes or whatever and think about what you're doing, why you're doing it. And if you still feel compelled to do it, go do it. But I need you to stop that. And she said over the course of several months that being mindful of what she was actually doing, because then your mind just starts asking you questions. What's going on? Why am I doing this? Not in a judgmental way, but just being curious about what's going on. The curiosity becomes more of a reward. And the reward is less appealing because then you start thinking about, how do I feel right now? These are just physical sensations. Do I really want to do this? So there's a lot to it, but that's the basic idea. And she literally was able to overcome through mindfulness practices. So it's really a powerful thing when you allow your mind to start turn on the thinking part of the brain. And we kind of, you know, say, okay, caveman brain, I need you to calm down for a minute. Let me think about what I'm doing here. And it's really cool. And you could do it for anything. You know, some of us are addicted to our phones and all these other things. Social media, it's the same thing. All these little things and things that we hear is like, oh, you got a message. Oh, you got a Facebook. Oh, you got a text message. It's hard not to like stop what you're doing and say, oh, I got a text message. Oh, someone sent me a message, you know? So, but you can use the same ideas for the same thing, but he has a book called The Creating Mind. So, but the beauty of this is we can help you dissect it. You know, we are an observer from the outside who've seen so many patients go through all these things that we can help you guide you into that practice of being mindful or using, you know, different approaches such as Chris has done very successfully for herself. But yeah, like you said, everyone's different, but it's a journey, guys. There's going to be wins and losses, but you just, as long as you keep moving towards the target.
And Lori, I actually got his app and I have been using it. So it's one more tool in my own tool belt. Tina, your question there is, so what Tina has commented here is that she got, she's been doing whole food plant-based for 10 weeks and suddenly she got cravings again. And so she's been not been eating any of that. So she's wondering what happened, why would that happen? And so that is why food addictions are so freaking sneaky and they do this to us. They sneak up when you least expect it, when maybe you're stressed. Maybe there was a trigger, like what Lori's talking about, something that would have triggered you in the past, somehow got in your mind, and the mind is like a wolf. It'll run with it, and it's the animal instinct. It wants you to get that fat, that calorie, that craving in back in you, and so that's what's happening with it, and they will keep sneaking up. The episodes will become smaller and fewer and less frequent over time, but I've had them sneak up 2 years into it, right, but less, and this is where tools like what Lori's talking about are essential. So having tools to deal with it is really, really important. So making sure that, first of all, that you're eating a whole food plant-based diet. So making sure a nice, full, fiber-rich meals that you're satisfied is really important. Making sure we're drinking enough water, dealing with other things like stress. So what's going on in your life right now? Are you stressed out? Because that will definitely bring back food addictions. And we know this happens to all of us when you have a life stressor, a life event, something bad happens. What happens? People fall off their plans, right? We go back to the old ways. It all comes back to haunt us. Even if we're doing so well for so long, that's when we need these tools. We have to do tons of self-care, work on our stress, get plenty of sleep. Food addictions come back when we're not rested. So we want to exercise. Exercise helps us overcome our food addictions, builds self-confidence, builds how you feel about yourself, and circulates all the toxins out of you. It lights up, you know, gets rid of anxiety in our brain. It's the best medicine for our brains, for brain health, is exercise. So doing all of those things, and then also having these mindful tools. So being able to write it out, being able to look into this addiction, this saying, what is going on? And, you know, with curiosity and laughing at it. That's what I do now. I'd laugh at my food craving. I'm like, that's really funny that you want me to eat that now. Like, you know, I'm like, obviously I'm exaggerating, but that's what I do to that wolf, that food craving that's haunting me. And it haunts our patients. So we have all these tools to keep us strong, to help us. In addition to abstinence, which of course is important for, especially for those highly addicted of us. So
absolutely.
That's my answer to that.
And I couldn't agree more, Chris, 100%. And like I said, if you guys have questions, feel free to put them in the Q&A box. If you're on the webinar or if you're on Facebook watching us on the Plant-Based Telehealth, please type them in the comments and we'll be happy to answer your questions. And we did have an email question for today. It says, I have an 11-year-old granddaughter who has exercise-induced asthma, flaky scalp, itchy skin, a bit overweight, stays up late, wakes up late, doesn't like to exercise, likes to snack on cheese, chips, and goldfish snacks. Her meals consist of chicken nuggets, macaroni and cheese, and pizza. Oh my. I think the whole food plant-based diet would make her healthier. Absolutely. Is there one book, video, or movie I could suggest to her mother that might convince her to help her daughter to change the diet? Oh boy. So there are so many layers to that question. So first of all, where do you begin? Yeah. So this is my thought on this. And you guys know I talk about my kids a lot. They're young adults now. I'm very blessed. They've chosen to eat healthy and have promoted, you know, them for themselves and others around them a whole food plant based diet. But as a parent, I don't think when they're smaller that we understand what we're doing to our kids. And I would come from it the approach, honestly, I would get her the book called The Craving Mind by Dr. Jabir, and I would read it yourself first and then hand it to her, because what the child's doing, she's modeling the behavior, I'm assuming, that other people in the home eat this way. So I would approach it from your daughter saying, you know, hey, this is, you know, who's the mother of the granddaughter. This is, you know, my concern is that what we're doing is we're laying down the foundation for your daughter, my granddaughter, to be very ill. So we're laying down food addiction, right? She's wanting cheese, processed food. She's already suffering the consequences of inflammation in the diet. You've got skin inflammation. The body is yelling, I am not well. And she's a child. So this is where the parent has to understand we hold responsibility for our children's health to a degree. Obviously things happen and, you know, unfortunate diagnoses occur. I'm not saying that, but when we look at things like, you know, being overweight or irritable bowel issues or, you know, skin things, and we're looking at these because we understand that we're not feeding our children the healthy diet, we have to take responsibility for that. And we can only allow what's in their environment to be healthy. These are children. Some people go, well, I want my children to make those independent decisions. Well, would you go let them live independently? They're not ready for that right now. So we have to make it understand that we have to guide them, teach them, so they can make those better decisions. We don't just let children run feral. You know, there are some people who believe in that. I don't. Because I think if you let them run feral, they're going to, you know, hopefully they turn out okay, but there's going to be some issues. You got to tend the garden. So I'm a big fan of thinking at kids as, here's my garden and I want it. I have this little seed and I put it in the soil and we're going to water it and we're going to give it sunshine. But sometimes you got to pull some weeds out of the garden so it'll grow and flourish. And sometimes you got to prune things back. You know, sometimes you got to add a little fertilizer, you know, so these are things you have to do. A child is just like that. It's a fertile garden that wants to grow and be fruitful, but we have to do the work. Gardening is not always easy, but if you lay the foundation with beautiful, you know, healthy soil, and you put that seed in there, you will get what you reap. I mean, that if you put that foundation early in their lives, still not too late. She's only, it sounds like 11. That would be so powerful for her. But first, I would come from a loving, not judging, and saying, you know, I really want her to be healthy and well. Can we try doing this for a little bit, maybe 30 days, and see if she doesn't feel better? Maybe she'll be more active. Maybe she won't have the asthma. Maybe she will breathe better. Maybe she'll have better skin. She's going to have more confidence because she's going to be entering into those preteen years, which is, I don't know anybody that enjoyed their preteen years, but if you're already walking into it not well, it's not going to get easier. And hormones are going to be fluctuating. There's so much going on in those little bodies at that time. Oh my goodness. So let's try to make this transition as easy as possible. So that would be my hope as a mother, that someone would bring me that message lovingly and open, but understanding you may be rejected because mom may be dealing with her own situation. I don't know, but that can be some sticky complications and it depends on their relationship. But, you know, like I agree that handing the book, Forks Over Knives, would be another good one to start with. There's another one, that video. I don't remember, I can't remember. But Chris, if you have anything, I'll find the video and I'll give you guys, it's a really powerful where it talks, there's a young man in this video who has a heart attack at like 35 and he's into the ER and it's from his perspective and he's laying there and they're ripping him open. The doctor goes, how did this happen? And I'll leave out the expletives. And they go backwards literally in time, like time just watching. So he goes back to the day before and he's driving to the drive-thru and then he's growing up and he's in his teen years and he's chowing down hamburgers and he's hiding food and his mom's taking him to the doctor and he's like, he's got to lose weight and he's backing up. And then his teacher's giving him candy for doing well on a test and he's backing up and his mom's getting him French fries as he's sitting in a high chair. I mean, so it goes back and it's like, this starts now. It's a very powerful, but Chris, if you have anything else to say, and I'll find that video real quick.
Yeah, those are some wonderful points. You're such a good one because you had the experience of having your kids and what you've done with them. Or help them with. But I would also say, so I really like the video. It depends who the audience is. For a kid, and it's something like The Game Changer, that I think that's just a powerful, The Game Changer is a powerful video that's relatively new. It's on Netflix right now. And it gives a lot of the good science and shows healthy people, including that Dotsie Batch. And it shows how they did it to become strong and healthy. And I think that's a fabulous film. I also think it's something like Super Size Me might be really effective for this family because it's about how one person decides he's gonna go go to McDonald's every day for 30 days and eat his meals there. And it shows how all his numbers go bad, how badly he feels. And so it's kind of powerful and eye-opening. These types of things did something for me as well. And I share it with my patients because it helps us open our eyes to how powerful food is. We often don't realize just how bad these foods are for our bodies or how good the good foods are for our bodies. And so watching a film like this helps us start to understand. And then we start to see other people making the change and tips on how to make it. And then following things like finding support. So following, doing exactly what you're doing by watching this, try to get the kiddo involved in this and the family involved. And what are the parents eating, right? It's so important. And then things like Healthy Human Revolution and joining some basic groups and getting the group support. And that's what I would say to get started on it.
Yeah. So here's the video. It's called Rewind the Future. And if you go to the Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, Strong with the number 4 Life on YouTube, it's had over almost 10 million views. But Rewind the Future, Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, Strong for Life, and you'll find it. And it's powerful. It gives me goosebumps every time I watch. Like I could just, it's just, I use it in my speeches. It's phenomenal, but absolutely. Yeah. For young men, I think the Game Changers is really powerful. I'll tell you a funny story. So I saw it first time with my my son was 19 and we had gone, he had broken his leg, unfortunately, is another story, but and we'd gone to see it in here in Boulder. He's at CU, our University of Colorado, and I took him to it and I'm sitting next to him and they do that part about, you know, sexual function and all that type of stuff. And they have young men eating it. I was like, see the gifts, you see. And he's like, oh my heavens, my mom. Anyway, so just be aware there are some parts like that. So if you feel uncomfortable, that, you know, I'm all about harassing your children while you can. So anyway.
I love that one for healthy people. Cause I often feel like people think that a plant-based diet is for people who are unhealthy. And I've heard, in talking to patients who knew nothing about plant-based diets, they'll say, well, it's good for a sick person, but I'm healthy. I don't need that. And that movie shows me that, nope, it makes us our best self. So it's a good one for getting started on. So.
Absolutely. You're exactly right. So, and it's powerful because these are athletes. These are people that we look at and respect in society. And I think it can move a lot of people in the right direction. So Absolutely. So again, if you guys have any questions, please put them in the Q&A box or on Facebook in the comment section. We'll be happy to answer them.
About your own journey with food addictions and food cravings, or what foods are you craving, or any success stories or struggles or anything. So you've had some of those struggles.
Yeah, absolutely.
Some of our struggles. So another interesting point about food addictions is that those dopamine receptors that we have, so dopamine is the pleasure center of our brain, and we need dopamine because we need to do certain things that are pleasurable. We need to have sex, reproduce as a species. So that's pleasurable, that lights up dopamine. We need to eat. So that's pleasurable, that lights up dopamine. And we need shelter and warmth and comfort. And so that these things are light up our dopamine receptors. And so some people, it turns out, will have more dopamine receptors than others. And so certain people need to go for even more with cravings. And so that's been an interesting finding, to think who has more receptors or less receptors, and you're going to need to find even stronger stimulants. These might be some of the people that tend to get more highly addicted easily to drugs or alcohol or food or sex or who knows or whatever, just more highly addicted. But the good news is we can all overcome that. Those are more of the people that same thing, just complete abstinence from whatever is triggering that, whatever certain food or drug or sex or shopping or whatever the addiction is, just to completely overcome it. But it is interesting to think that it's a uniquely individual struggle that we have, although we're all, so many of us are sharing that. But also ask yourself that, are you on a plan and then you fall off? And I do a lot of journaling. I have my patients do a lot of journaling. In fact, I have my journal right here next to me, but I will often say, look at your journal. What is happening in your life when you're falling off that addiction? Are you feeling good and life is awesome at that point, or something usually triggers us? And so take a look at what is going on and really build a robust self-care. Self-care makes a huge difference for your addictions. In addition to eating the right foods and stocking the house and having a plan and knowing your purpose, but taking good care of yourself, big picture, and having the support. Support is another key thing to overcoming your food addiction. So for those of you who are struggling with it, anytime you fall off the plan, you're on it, you're eating perfectly, and then you're not, ask yourself why. Take a look at a journal, look at what's going on in those days. And usually you can start to tease it out and find the triggers. And that's where you work on the self-care to prevent that from happening. So instead of being beating yourself up and saying, oh my God, I suck at this, I am so weak. You're not weak and you don't suck at it. I can promise all of you that right now. What is happening is that you're falling into self-sabotage because you haven't built the support system. You haven't built the robust self-care. You don't have the tools yet to overcome how powerful of force these food addictions are. So instead of being upset with yourself, you can take that as a learning experience. And so at the end of the day, you want to look at your journal and be like, what can I learn from today, which equals what not didn't go quite as perfectly as you wanted it to, right? Instead of beating yourself up, it's a learning experience. So what did I learn today? Gosh, I learned that when I'm stressed out, I still want to eat dried fruit and I'll overeat it. Oh, that's great that I learned that. That's a wonderful learning experience. How, and then the next part of that is, how am I going to overcome that tomorrow? What happens when I'm stressed out tomorrow? What am I going to do? Well, I'm going to throw out all the dried fruit right now in my house. So it's not in my house. And I'm going to do a little more meditation, deep breathing in the morning, and try to get a little more sleep tonight. So I'm not so tired and I have more tools in my belt. So tomorrow's another day. And then I'll see what I did, how well I did, and I'll celebrate my wins. And I'll see, what am I learning from today or from the next day? And then you keep building on that. So you start to get more of the tools so that you can overcome those addictions. So that's another little tip that I like to share with my patients.
Yeah, I think journaling is very powerful because sometimes we forget how difficult, you know, or how far we've actually come. And, you know, you got to think, I think self-care is a really big one, Chris, because I think, you know, the one person that we speak to the most harshly is the person looking back at us from the mirror. So when we think about that, would we, you know, the things that we speak to ourselves, would we ever say to another human being that we care about? And so, you know, I think we have to understand that this community is important, having that support, but loving yourself for every, all the faults. You know, earlier before we started, we were comparing wrinkles and you, so, you know, you got to love all parts of you. It's your, you know, is it easy? No. Sometimes, and sometimes we're disappointed in our, you know, whatever we've done, but we just get up and dust ourselves off or give ourselves and move on. Tomorrow's a new day. And so I think it's really important to have someone in your corner cheering you on when some days you just feel like you can't. And so that's really, really important. So I think that's the beauty of bringing together as much of a community as possible. So we do have a question. Can sugar addiction get worse? And by that, I mean, can my cravings expand, say, from refined sugars to honey, then dates, then bananas? I think that's a yes. You want to, you kind of speak to your own experience, Chris. You mentioned that kind of a little bit earlier.
Yeah, Tina, absolutely. They do. They can. These things, I'm telling you, they're wolves. They're wild wolves in our brains, and they run with it. So absolutely, they get worse, and they can get worse. So I had the same thing happen to me where there was a couple years I had no dates in my house. I would eat the entire package every time. And for some reason, I would think, this is the day I can just have one date, or I can have something sweetened with a date. Or I'd read about this beautiful recipe shared by, you know, somebody super healthy and think, okay, that's, and I never could do it, never. So I had to get rid of dates. And then bananas, yes, they can be so sweet. I would have the same thing. If I ate watermelon, which was so sweet, it became a trigger to overeat and then to crave more sweets. So they can. And so some tools for that, what I would say is find out what your triggers are. If right now dates and bananas are triggering you, then get them out of the house or hide them. If someone else in your family is eating them, get them out of your kitchen, kind of out of sight, out of mind. Do your best to get it kind of far away from you, so it's not something you look at every day, and replace it with something. So for me, it always helps to replace it. I love berries. I love berries. And I sometimes am mindful of how much they cost to buy organic berries. So I won't always have tons of berries in my house. But when I'm having these trigger moments, when I'm feeling the cravings pretty strong, I will put berries, extra berries in my house. And then I really will start journaling, and I'm going to look at what's going on in my life. Why am I craving things so much right now? Am I not getting sleep? Am I really stressed out? Am I not eating proper meals? Sometimes I don't eat proper plant-based meals. I'll eat a little salad, but that's not enough to sustain me. And so 2 hours later, I'm starving. I might be craving some of my fruit. Or am I just reading a ton and I'm falling asleep? So then I want to eat something sweet, like a good piece of watermelon, which wakes me up and then makes me crave more sweets. So what is it that's making me want that so badly? And what happens is over time, so I'll get those things out. I'll try to get to the bottom of why I'm having these cravings and distract myself, drink plenty of water, eat good meals, get sleep, work on my stress. And over time, it gets better. So I now have dates in my house and I'm not eating them anymore. There was about 3 years that I did not have a single date in my house, and now it doesn't faze me at all. I'm still not eating them, but they're there. My husband will eat them. I'll make a plant-based dessert and give it away to someone else or share it for a family thing or something. Mm-hmm. But that is better. I do eat bananas. I do eat watermelon and I'm fine. Now I can take 2 cups of watermelon, put it in a bowl and eat that and be good with it. So I don't eat the whole water, half a watermelon anymore, like I have done in the past. So that will get back. So those are some of my tips for you to help with some of that.
I think those are great. And we had another question. If you're at someone's house and they offer you a trigger food, how do you work with the situation? So I think there's several ways to do that. Number one, going in, planning for such a thing, because it will happen at some point somewhere. And I think it depends on the someone. So if it's someone you don't know and they're not going to make some irritating, sabotaging comment, you can just say, oh, I'm on a special diet. My doctor says I have to eat this way. I always tell my patients, you can blame this on me all you want. You could tell them I'm crazy and I'm insane and she talked me into this crazy diet. You know, I'm like, I got broad shoulders, bring it on. So that, I'm happy to take that. Even if I'm not your doctor, you can blame it. I heard this crazy doctors on plant-based health, do they love, that's fine. The other thing is, one, just say, you know, thank you so much, but it's outside of what I'm currently eating. I'm trying to sustain a really healthy diet. And I'm, you know, be transparent and open with them and saying, I'm afraid that's going to lead me down a path that I'll struggle to get back from. But thank you so much for the thoughtful, you know, offer. But I just can't do that right now. And being vulnerable and transparent with people makes them less likely to be abrasive and make, you know, because they're going to be less offended if you say no to their food. Because a lot of people, you know, I'm married to a Filipino, so in an Asian home, if you're offered food, it's expected you'll eat it. But at this point, they just stop offering it to me because I'm like, I just politely say, no, I'm sorry, I can't eat that. And so, but then, you know, it's not that you want to say, if you just put it back on yourself and say, you know, I struggle with certain foods and I'm worried that that might trigger me to eat foods that I don't want to. And I'm dealing with, you know, if you want to share a health consequence or whatever, that's one way. Then they're not offended because it's back on you. It's your issue. It's not them. It's not the food. And just say, thank you so much for the gracious offer, but I'll have to decline. I'm sure there's someone here that would so much more enjoy it than I would. So, you know, that's one way. Chris, do you have any other thoughts?
Yeah, that's great. I like that. Let, you know, be honest with them. A couple things. When I say own it, you know, I think we need to be leaders. So the fact that you're making changes for your health, just be proud of that. And just like, whatever it takes, whatever you're comfortable with, if you're comfortable. If you're not comfortable talking about it, which I often don't want to talk about either when I'm not at work, I just want to let it be. If you don't want to talk about it all, that's totally cool. And, you know, you can do something like what Lori just said and tell them that you heard it from a doctor and you're working on your health and just kind of leave it at that. But you could also own it and just be proud of it and let them know, you know, that this is who I am. This is just, I'm the type of person who doesn't eat that. But what also you may be asking, which I'm not sure, but is what do you do for if it's a trigger food and it's something that might make you think and now want it again? One is, you know, decide before you go to the party or wherever you're going, a friend's house or going out, that you're not going to eat that. You're the type of person that doesn't eat those foods. And so if they offer you your trigger food, no, thank you, you know, I'm good. And you don't eat it there. But and for me, that part's easier. because I can have a glass of water, I can talk to someone, I can distract myself and get away from it. And if I don't have one, then I don't want any. So that part's easy for me. If I had even just one though, that would be badness. But it's I can walk away. Don't stand near it. Don't be near people that are even eating it if it's really bad at that moment. Whatever you have to do to get away from it and stay strong. But here's where it can be sneaky is, and I've had this happen, I'll be strong at the party. No way, I'm not having that. I'm the type of person who doesn't eat that. Oh, yay me, I did it. And then I'll go home and it's on my head and now I'm craving something else and I'll end up eating something, overeat something, even a plant-based thing because I had that strong moment but my willpower ran out by the time I got home and maybe I'm gonna rampage my house to see if I have any dried fruit or raisins or dates or anything that I can sneak in. So I have been known to do that. So that's where I come home. Now I know this happens. So I come home and I'm strong and I don't even go in the kitchen and I suck down some water and make some herbal tea. And maybe I need to do a quick workout, whatever I need to do after that party to keep myself strong. I've learned that lesson. So that can be a tough one. So build your tools, know ahead of time what you're going to do. And like Lori was saying, plan for it. That'll hopefully get you far.
Yeah. And I think it's just, you have to navigate. And it's the more you interact with people about this, like you go out with people and you're making different choices, you'll come up with certain sayings that you say and do different things. So it gets easier, guys. It really, really does.
I don't want you, like Tina said, well, poo, I don't want you to think this is totally grim. Like I am happier now, way happier. And I feel this freedom that I'm not thinking about food anymore. I'm not fighting my food addictions. I'm at a peace and I feel good about myself. So I would say it takes some work at the beginning and some commitment, but once you get into it, it's like learning to ride a bike. It's hard. And then boom, you soar on the bike, right? Then it's beautiful and the wind is in your face and life is good and you're cruising. So it's tricky while you're learning and you're developing your tools and then you're going to soar. So keep at it. It will get you.
Absolutely. So we have a couple more questions and we're going to wind down here. It says here, I know I have food addictions, been off and on a vegan diet for many years. I can do without cheese and other dairy, sugar, and animal products. But if I go just 3 days without salt, I feel my body is telling me to have a small amount of salt. Can you speak to the need for salt or natural sodium? Oh my. So salt is another one of those food addictions. It takes about 2 weeks. So for your taste buds to kind of get beyond that. But salt is a pretty tough one for people. I say you just kind of bear through it. It's that, you know, when you say your body needs it, it's the craving. It's the craving for salty foods. So, and then if you just, you know, every time you have that feeling, if you eat salt, it's going to make that craving harder to overcome next time. So I think that's where just like the mindfulness tricks, as far as, I mean, it's a trick, these are tools. But, you know, just being aware of what's the sensation that you're having, you know, what is going on. So foods and, you know, fruits and natural already have sodium, but the key here is the iodine. So in salt, we just want to make sure that, because iodine foods like sea vegetables have some iodine, there's a few others, but, you know, make sure that you're taking a small amount of stuff. If you're eating a strictly whole food plant-based diet, maybe without, if you're not doing sea vegetables like kelp and stuff. I do have one in my vegan multivitamin that has just a small amount because it can mess with your thyroid and stuff. But this sounds more like you said, the craving, and then you just have to be a little bit careful with that. So any other thoughts there, Chris? Because we have three more questions too.
One quick thing is, you're doing exactly what Lori said in beginning to taper down on your salt, is adding things like lemon or lime, because that can, the taste buds for sour and salty are right next to each other. And so that way you may not miss it as much, or using spices to kind of change the flavor so you don't miss the salt. And like she said, over time cravings will start to get less. So stick with it. So just make your food taste good and your body will gradually get used to having less salt. So
absolutely. And Camille has a question. I don't have much problem with food addictions. My big problem with eating plant-based diets is that I have continued to lose weight and have digestive problems. Starting eating plant-based fall 2018, all the bloating and gas when weight was awesome. Lost looks like she lost some weight. And then on about June 2nd, after eating at a restaurant, I started getting digestive issues and it hasn't stopped. Lasting over a year now, lots of gas, super smelling, so embarrassing to be around people, bloating, soft stools, etc. I'm now down to 98 pounds and 5'6". Do you either of you have knowledge experience in this area? So these are definitely food intolerances, Chris, I think is so right up your alley. Do you have any thoughts or suggestions?
So this would be something I would definitely recommend starting to journal over. Write down what you're eating and what you're feeling. If you are eating something that your body is not absorbing it, you're not digesting it, you're not breaking down, even if it's a super healthy food, it's not healthy for you right now. Your gut, your microbiome is out of balance, the bacteria, and the gut lining is could be out of balance as well and disrupted. And so we want to fix that microbiome, rebalance it, and heal the gut lining. That's something that you could work with one of us if you are interested. Yes, we do work with people who don't tolerate foods and help build a more robust microbiome and heal the gut lining so they start to tolerate more foods. We have to remove the trigger foods and that are irritating their guts or that their bacteria aren't digesting properly, and add foods that they are able to digest. And sometimes that's a slow process, and we bring it in slowly. We can use supplements to help balance the microbiome as well as heal the gut lining. So I'd be happy to work with you if you're in one of my states, or Lori could too if you're in one of her states. So that's something that you want to have addressed.
Yeah, and that's really serious. The low weight that you're describing is highly concerning for malnutrition and vitamin absorption. So if you're not under the care of someone soon, I would encourage you to do that. That's highly concerning. So there's another comment from Jennifer. She said, I'm trying to start over this week after several days of, let's see here. Okay, after several days of not doing well, I find it a struggle on the days when I'm not sure what to do that day, like boredom, uncertainty, etc. Today, the cravings are strong after 2 days of doing great. So Jennifer, just being aware of it, I'd say on days that you're not sure what to do, fill those days with being knowledge, right? So use your natural curiosity to overcome these type of things. So what is there a special hobby that you want to learn? Or maybe you want to read more, like I said, Dr. Jeb Brewer's Craving, The Craving Mind is a great book. So on those days that you're worried, start filling your mind with tools and the knowledge that you'll need to be able to structure your environment so you don't also fall prey. You know, make sure your environment's in a good spot, you know, that there's things at home that need to be taken out. If you live with others that don't eat this way, maybe you ask them to put it somewhere that it's not easily accessible to you. There's lots of solutions. So I think this is just a matter of preparation because you know those days are going to come. So this is just like if you practice for a race. You don't just go into running a marathon without practicing. You need to, you know, practice the short runs and the longer runs, and you do your speed drills and your tempo runs, but you are know you're going to be at the starting line and you know there's going to be a hard time. So you practice for those. That's how gold champions win gold. Like Michael Phelps, when he was swimming and he was in this race and his goggle fell, but he had gone through that, you know, process of that happening so many times, he was prepared. When I was in the military, when I was in the Air Force, we did drills so that when we practiced, when we were in situations where we had to think instinctively, we already knew what to do. So it's a matter of using the tools and getting the knowledge so you have them. So Chris, do you have anything else to say to that?
I don't have anything to add to that. That was awesome. I agree 100%. That was a great answer.
Cool. And then another, Camille says she's under no care and she's in Utah. We do have Utah, so please feel free to make an appointment if you want, Camille.
And we may recommend, just so you know, other some testing. Sometimes people do need a colonoscopy or other workup, but yeah. Certainly for me, sometimes we need both, right? We need the regular workup to make sure nothing else is going on if it's depending on what symptoms you're having, but I would be happy to work with you. And tease that out and definitely take a look at your food and start the healing process right away.
Yeah, because Chris, you have Utah, right?
I have Utah, yeah.
I would highly recommend Chris for this because her lupus and her stories with food and
messed up guts. My gut was a mess.
She would be phenomenal for this. I'd be happy to help with you, but I think Chris would be right up your alley. Another question is, my doctor thinks I have IBS and he wants me to adopt the FODMAP diet. I'm whole food plant-based and worried about taking beans out of the equation. Any recommendations? Yes, Monica, I have lots of suggestions for you, and it's not the FODMAP diet because it's meant, if you look at the research, FODMAP diet is meant to be a very short-term, let's overcome some serious, you know, symptoms currently for a short period of time. It's not meant to be a long-term issue. Beans are highly helpful, but we just got to gradually move into it. So if IBS, there's a marriage between a different type of diet and certain medications that can be very, very beneficial. And I work with these people all the time, as does Chris. So we could definitely help you with that. But yeah, Chris, do you have any other thoughts there?
No, we can definitely help you with that. If IBS is so very common, and you may initially need to take out some of these foods, and you start with foods that are not going to irritate you, and you build a healthy microbiome that is not going to be gas producing. And that's what Lori and I help with, adding in the proper food in the proper order so that you rapidly get a fiber-rich diet, but you're able to tolerate it again. So we're resensitizing your gut, and we use herbs, and we have some medications if we need to for certain patients, and we also have the food to use all as our tools. So we'd be happy to help you with that. Absolutely.
All right. And Camille's asking how to connect with Chris. So basically you want to go to plantbasedtelehealth.com. Request on that very front page is request a portal invite, and you just send that in. We'll send you an invite right away, and then you can schedule an appointment. See Chris literally this week or early next week.
Absolutely.
We're super excited. We're in Minnesota, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Definitely.
Yeah, we're both in Minnesota, Laura.
I have 35 licenses, and there's more coming. So I actually lose track, honestly, guys, at this point. I'm like, I don't know where I am in the United States anymore. I'm like, I think Chris is in Minnesota. But yes, we're in Minnesota. And Camille says thank you. And
you're Chris, very welcome. I look forward to getting to work with you, Camille.
Camille, she's my doctor. How about that? Okay. All right. So Jude had a question. This will be our last question we have time for here. I had a salt question. I have a thyroid and hyperparathyroid problems. Very interesting. My PTH, which is parathyroid hormone, and calcium levels, which regulates calcium, guys, for those who don't know. Just wondering how much to know if I need iodine or need to keep eat kelp type foods. That would be test, don't guess. Let's check some labs and look at what you're consuming food wise. And then we'd have some good answers for you. And any questions or suggestions there, Chris?
No, you do have to be a little bit more careful with certain supplements though. So that's where, like, everyone thinks supplements are so benign, but if you have thyroid issues and parathyroid issues, hyperparathyroid issues, then it's important that you're careful. So things like iodine, you want to have regulated. Also vitamin D, D3 can be overabsorbed and cause problems with calcium. So you do want to be careful with that.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's where I tell people you have to think of supplements as medications.
Yeah.
So, you know, we are a system, and there is nothing, just because it's a supplement doesn't mean that it is benign, exactly like Chris says. So really, really important that, you know, you speak to someone who understands the whole picture, like myself or Chris or some of our other docs that are joining us shortly. Tody asked if we're in Florida and North Carolina. Yes, we are in both of those states. And Monica says, thank you.
You're welcome.
So thank you, everybody. What a wonderful talk.
Awesome questions. Thank you for participating and sharing with us today. We really appreciate that.
Yeah, and the replay is going to be up on our Facebook page, which is Plant-Based Health. If you haven't liked us, give us a like, and you'll be notified when we do go live with these every Thursday at noon Mountain Standard Time, which is 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And they will also be on our YouTube page. Check out our YouTube page. It's Plant-Based Telehealth. We also have Instagram, where we pull out little segments of here, and we have questions of the day. And we really appreciate you guys spending some time with us. We always are honored to be a part of your lives and your journey to health. And so have a great afternoon. Chris, anything?
Thanks, everybody. No, thanks for sharing your day with us. Take care and stay strong. We can all do this.
Absolutely. And you guys have a fantastic day. Take care.
Bye.